it is befitting that there is a TEDx event on the occasion of Saraswati Puja. There is so much of learning to and fro that the goddess Saraswati would really be glad. Friends, I am here to take you on a journey that I have been through with the hope that you would also enjoy it as much as I have. You have all heard the term to take at face value. What does that mean? When we love and trust a face, we take whatever they say as the gospel truth. We believe. When we see some faces, it sparks a happiness within us. We feel warm. We wonder how they do it. Some faces inspire respect. We want to be like them, emulate them, be a hero. But then when we see a few faces, we are filled with disgust, horror, even fear. All these feelings are because of the deeds these people have done. But even then, the face seems to be the mirror of the soul. So, what about these faces? What do you feel? Horror? Disgust? Pity? What is their face value? This is a condition called congenital cleft of the lip and the palate. Congenital means these children were born with this deformity. Is this very common? Yes. About 35,000 children are born with this defect every year. Somewhere in the world, a child was born with a cleft lip every 2 minutes. And in India, it is 3 per hour. That means before my TED talk is over, there will be again a new child born with this defect. What causes this problem? 20% of the times we know it is because of the fault in our genes. We see a father and a mother bringing a baby who also has a cleft. The father and mother also have clefts. But then 80% of the time it is because of malnutrition. A young mother in the early stages of pregnancy from a poor family just does not have enough to eat, causing what is called a folic acid deficiency. So what happens in a folic acid deficiency? Around 6 to 8 weeks of intrauterine life, the baby in the womb develops its face as separate bulges, and all these bulges fuse together to form the upper lip, the gum, and the palate. If something goes wrong during that time, then these bulges don't fuse together but break at the seams and form these clefts. In North Bengal, I run the only Smile Train program. It is running successfully for about 12 years now, and I have done about 4,000 surgeries so far. Now, before I tell you more about Smile Train and me, I would like to tell you a little story of how I came to be here. I am a Tamilian, born and brought up in Chennai, enjoying the Marina Beach. But from a very small age, I had one passion, and that is to do medicine, and that too from Madras Medical College. But when you enter the college for the first time, the first class they take you to would be like a horror show. The anatomy dissection hall, a huge hall with rows and rows of steel tables having dead bodies or cadavers reeking of formalin. Many students will faint at that sight. But at that juncture, two types of doctors emerge. One who will stand around the table and read, but maintain an arm's length from the cadaver. And the other who would fall all over the body, marvel at dissection, find out the anatomy and display it with pride. The first set of doctors would become the physicians. and the second set would become the surgeons. As you can well imagine, I was of the second type. But then, wanting to be a surgeon and really becoming one are two different things completely. Why? Even now, it is unconventional for a lady to take up surgery as a specialty. My father, who's otherwise my rock, asked me, "Are you sure? Do you think men will come to you to get operated upon?" But then I stood firm. And I, through the All India Medical PG entrance, I got MS in General Surgery at SAB Medical College, Cuttack in Orissa. And there I landed into a very, very different problem. That college, until then, hadn't had a lady surgery postgraduate. So they were baffled. They did not know what to do. No unit was willing to take me in. They thought I was a freak. I will be insincere. I will quit. I've had people peeking in the windows to look at me, an anomaly. Those few weeks almost broke me. But then, because I was most happy being within the operation theater, I stayed put. Our hospital has a system that the PGs who handle the emergencies are given signed slips by the assistant professor in charge so that the PG can handle the emergencies without any hassles for the day. Within 1 month of working in a new place, an alien language, and a very different work environment, my assistant professor handed me the slips. From that point on, I became one of their favorite students, and I made some long-lasting relationships in Orissa. Not least of all, I met my future husband there. After finishing my MS, I joined as assistant professor in Ramachandra Medical College, worked in state-of-the-art operation theaters, started training undergraduate medical students, surgical postgraduates. I got married, had two kids, was settling in life slowly, peacefully, and safely. But then isn't always being safe boring? And then you go about complicating matters. Driven with the passion to do much more, I set out to super specialize in plastic surgery. So what happened? From being a teacher, I became a student again. More important, from having a salary, I was reduced to a measly stipend, and there was a family to run. At that same time, Ramachandra signed an agreement with some hospital in Kuch Bihar. And my husband, being a Bengali, they told him to go there and work. Kuch Bihar? Where is that? Is it somewhere in Bihar? I said, is it even safe? I only agreed to this proposition because he was getting paid 3 times the salary that he was making then as an assistant professor. So my husband decided to go there and work for 3 years until I finished my post-graduation. As fate would have it, he fell in love with Kuch Bihar, the Himalayas, the forest, the greenery, and the field being completely empty, he rose in eminence as a surgeon too. So he said, let's all shift residence to Siliguri. Before 2006, I had not heard the name of Siliguri before. I said, fine. How many plastic surgeons are there in Siliguri? I asked him. And he said, none. How many hospitals there are doing plastic surgery? And he says, none. Okay. Is there any hospital who's at least looking for a plastic surgeon? He says, no. Is the government medical college here having a plastic surgery department? No. Here I was, a Tamilian, an assistant professor in a modern medical college in Chennai, having 2 kids who were studying in one of the best schools in India at the time. I was having a buffered existence. There was my HOD, my professor above me, my tutors, my PGs, interns behind me. And I had to leave all that and climb alone. To where? Will I even make it somewhere? Or will I fade into oblivion? The first hurdle that I had to face was the biggest. But I had to take a leap of faith, knowing very well that even from there, it will be an uphill climb. But maybe when you take such leaps of faith is when miracles happen. I joined Anandaluk Hospital in Siliguri solely because our MD was also a dynamic person who believed in taking chances. I started the plastic surgery department there, the first of its kind in North Bengal. And then I joined hands with Smile Train. Initially, we used to conduct camps in various places to spread awareness that we were going to do these cleft surgeries free throughout the year. But now, the project has grown to such an extent that the West Bengal government has recognized us as the only cleft care center in the region. And through their RBSK scheme, they bring the children right from Dakshin Dinajpur, Uttar Dinajpur, Alipurdwar, Kuch Bihar, Jaigaon, Darjeeling, Jalpaiguri to our hospital for treatment. Not only that, we get patients from Bihar, Kishanganj and Islampur in Bihar, from Bhutan, Nepal, and even Bangladesh, Sikkim, to our hospital for treatment. But what do I do exactly? I start off with parents who have had an ultrasound and then they have said that their unborn child has a cleft. This news hits them with shock, with disbelief, with despair. Many of them do not even want to continue the pregnancy. But then I counsel those parents that yes, their child has a problem, but given the correct treatment, they will be as normal as any other child will be. Moreover, such quality treatment is not only available regionally, but also free. I tell them to look for other congenital anomalies that can be more serious and assuage them that whatever has happened is not their fault. And then when the child is born, there are another set of problems. In former times, the cleft lip was called the hair lip because people thought that it occurred because the mother was startled by looking at a hair and the child looks like a hair. Here in India, I would call it the eclipsed lip. Time and again, I have to convince the husbands, the in-laws, that this condition did not occur because the mother went out during her pregnancy during an eclipse. But that is the strong superstition here. When such a child with a deformity is born, the family loses pride and prestige in the society. The family is completely ostracized from the village. The father is ridiculed. The mother is even called as a witch. Many times in former age, such cleft children were just left out, thrown out to die. And I see similar frustrations in the parents even today because they have to deal with a sick child. Because of the cleft, the lip cannot generate enough suction to suckle from the breast, and so the child cannot breastfeed. Whatever else you feed the child also, it will come through the nose. And therefore, the child repeatedly aspirates into the lungs and has respiratory infections. So the child cannot feed and repeatedly aspirates and thereby develops lung infections. Cannot, becomes malnourished and fails to thrive. And even if they go by this phase, then they cannot speak properly. Repeated ear infections means the hearing is impaired. And they have such an abnormal, grotesque face. So I tell the parents of such children what to feed, how to feed, so that the child can be fit enough to undergo the surgery. For the surgeries, I require that the child be only 3 months, at least weigh 5 kilos, and have a hemoglobin of 10 grams per cent. Believe me, even to achieve these parameters is a Herculean task. we get a chance not only to comprehensively care for the children, but also rehabilitate the entire family in the process. It has been an immense pleasure and pride to see these children with these crippling deformities grow up to be happy, beautiful, healthy children. They approach life with confidence, with an attitude. They get a second chance at life. I give them a face value, and they end up enhancing mine in return. I realize that I'm slowly altering the social, the economic, and the mental fabric of the society in which I reside. What more can a person aspire for? But then, there are so many more magic moments, like this baby, Tithi. She lost her mother as soon as she was born, brought by worried grandparents who did not know what to do with this child. And then I operated on the lip and the palate, and she comes back to my office later like this. So friends, I leave you with this message. Follow your passion. Go wherever it leads you, despite the odds. Only then you will realize that you can make a huge impact. You can change not only your face value, but of all the people that you have come into contact with. Because I do what I do in Siliguri, the Ministry of Women and Child Development has recognized me as one of 100 women achievers of India, and the PMO, the United Nations, and the Niti Aayog has named me as one of 25 women transforming India. These accolades I could not have won if I had continued to stay put in Chennai. As Robert Frost famously said, two roads diverged in a wood, and I took the one less traveled by, and that has made all the difference. Thank you.